Now you listen to me real good. I've told you once, I said it 1,000 times. You get out of those pagan, satanic, religious, Christian churches. Christians do not follow the commandments of the Bible. Christians do what they want to do. They make up their own laws, their own rules, and their own regulations. Come out of her, my people, and come out from among them. And it's real simple and easy to ascertain who are these people you need to come out from. Easy. Number one, if they keep Sunday, that's an automatic sign that you need to not have any fellowship with these commandment-breaking, wicked deceivers and seducers and bewitchers of the truth. Simple. Let's go on. Sin. This message today, we have to go over this. I want all you young people, especially you little children, to pay attention. Because there's a world out there that's vying for your attention. And I'm going to tell you right now, you want to keep yourself preserved in Yah, you want to stay away from everybody that does not act the way that Yah created them. Because this world, what they want you to do is they want to say, let's everybody get along. Yeah. And you got these young perverts who have been taught by their perverted parents that have been trained predators. They want you to, one day you playing in a playground. And these trained predators who have been perverted by some other pervert seek to pervert your children. And put a spirit on him. And you shouldn't make no friendship or no leagues with any homosexuals, sodomites, or lesbians. Because in school, they're going to make you think, in these public school systems, there ain't nothing wrong with her having that girl. I don't have no homosexual friends. There's a spirit on them. And most of you are not spiritually in tune. Y'all remember the story I told you one day I was in Best Buy? I was walking around in Best Buy and stuff, and all of a sudden I felt some eyes peering down on me. I was like, what the world is that? You start feeling this uncomfortable spirit, right? You're like, what is that? I turn around and look, and there's this skinny, dreadlock, long hair, faggot eyeballing me. He don't know I'll break something off in his ass for sure. But see, this is a spirit that is going out for real. And I go, what the hell? I turn around and look at this booger. And I looked at him. It wasn't a good look either. My look is I'll come over and tear this whole damn store up with you. I'm telling you. So I kept walking around on the other side and I felt that dang same old spirit. I looked around, look at this damn devil. So I turned around and started walking to that booger. Because I wasn't walking like. This is a spiritual war we in. You ever felt that spirit that is in you when you have a connection with your wife? Your family? There's a fondness there. There's something spiritually going on there. This is a different type of spirit, and it's powerful. And since I keep trying my best to get you out. See, that's the time you're going to feel. But you need to put your feelings in the right place. Most of you have displaced feelings. Yeah, you do. When you have a feeling, you define all feeling as the same. There's a power in them. You better believe it. It's an evil demonic power. And if you're not living anything righteous, and if you don't have any righteousness in you at all, and if you ain't never been taught the scriptures to know what's good from bad, you'll entertain that spirit. Yeah, you will too. Because without force of breath, without words, there's something in the area. And that booger's seeking a draw. Why do you think the book says, don't sit down with another man's wife? You don't be going having lunch with somebody else's wife. That's an intimate situation there. Oh, no, it ain't. We just eating food. That's an intimate situation there. You're on sitting about 2 feet across the table and you look up and she look up and all of a sudden you think ain't nothing going to eventually go on? Look at them looking. See, I'm different. I got all these daughters of Zion in here and they all my daughters. I had Nadia and her hard-headed brother with me, Freeman, Lil Freeman. Why was we at when we met y'all and we said, hey, can we take them with us? And y'all said, sure. In North Carolina. And boy, they were happy to go with Pastor Dow. Sister Carol. Wasn't y'all? Y'all look at them cheesing. And boy, they ran to jump in the vehicle. Choo-choo-choo-choo-choo-poom. See, you got to have a strong spirit because you don't know out there in that world that there are family members that have done sexually abused other family members who's supposed to be loving. Yep. You better guard yourself. That's why around here, we're meticulous about our children. Oh, yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. We even got a couple of known pedophiles. Live right up here around the corner. They the ones that fly that rebel flag up there. I said, they good as long as they come up and down this corner. Let them bring their ass down here. They ain't got to do nothing. Just bring your ass down here. Because we don't play that any way, shape, fashion, or form. Because there is a demonic spirit on these people. These young people with these unsuspecting minds don't know unless we teach them. We're the ones that's charged to tell them what's right and what's wrong. And then you got the young girls, all the young girls, they supposed to be able to experience the love of a father. That's why if they don't have that, they end up experiencing love in all the wrong places. The little boys, they experience love of the father, but they're supposed to experience the manhood of a father. Because there's two different roles. And then when them little girls get older, that's why it says daddy, pow-pow, father. When you see your little girl, you talk to them, when you have to deal with them, you don't spare them. You deal with them rough. That ain't saying rough them up. They say, you be serious with them little manipulating monsters. You set their spirit straight. And because we don't do these principles anymore, we all going to end up like Sodom and Gomorrah unless there's a voice that is rising up in the wilderness. That's why I make no apologies at all when I'm saying all these negative and derogatory statements against those with these alternative lifestyles, because I want our children to have no mistake in their mind exactly what pastor is meaning and what the hell is right and what the hell is wrong.
Better believe it. This book, this society is so vile. I said to Sister Carol this morning, I said, you know what? I'm up here studying this morning. And y'all heard me talk about shit eaters, right? I said, let me type this in. I typed that mess in, and don't you know on Google, they actually have pictures up there of somebody defecating and somebody eating their shit while they're doing it? I'm up here thinking this is just a dang joke, but these people are serious. This wicked and perverted. Yah has got to destroy this country and this world. And it's coming too. And I'll be so happy when he bring the fire from glory on this wicked place. So when we preach and teach, we ain't leaving no room for misunderstanding. There's no gray areas. That's why I keep telling you, a good set apart holy community is a good place to raise children. Because the girls are always with the women. And the men and the boys, they're always together. We have very little interaction on a daily basis. Very little. There are sisters that sit in this tabernacle that I haven't even probably said, live on the community. Haven't probably said a word to them in 6 months. It's not that I don't love them. I just ain't got nothing to say to them. I know you're my sister. See, this type of holiness is dying out.
Oh, yeah.
I'm telling you, y'all don't feel the push of this world. We the last bastion, one of the last bastions. Yes, we are. This homosexual agenda is a very militant, evil, vile spirit. People try to impose their belief upon others. We live in a world where the system is trying to force their lifestyle upon all of society. Because I'm not trying to be politically correct, so anytime you see people out there apologizing or trying to force sports figures, you know, they get out there and they speak their upbringing in their heart, and then next thing you know, they bring political pressure for bear to get them to say, I'm sorry, to get them to say, you know, I didn't really mean what I said, and I misspoke. They better do it if they want to keep on receiving them paychecks. It's all about money. You may not even agree with the lifestyle, but when you get in front of them cameras, you better act like it.
Yep.
See, I'm not a hypocrite. Like, if I don't agree with the damn lifestyle, it's going to be like that even in front of the camera. Because
yeah.
I can't be bought. I'm already purchased.
Yes.
Already been bought. Y'all get it? So you watch these people capitulate and stuff because of political pressure. Jameis Winston, quarterback for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. They invited him to speak to some fourth graders. And what he did was told all the girls to sit down, boys, stand up. And he was trying to encourage the boys to be men. They turned around and then tried to say that he was really slanting and slighting the little girls in there. By trying to tell them, you know, the girls have a certain place. Yeah, you got there, girls do have a certain place. Your ass don't belong out there in a war zone in a foxhole. So-called graduating from Ranger School. Jumping out of a damn airplane. These are butches. And then next thing you know, he's up singing in front of the camera. I said, he better do that. Politically correct. These politicians, some of them may not agree with the lifestyle, but you better act like as long as you're representing the state. You better get up there and sing. So I don't care nothing about no dang being politically correct in this wicked world. And when you see these people apologizing and protecting people because of their alternative lifestyle, it's all about status and money. The great falling away. 1 John 3:4 says that whosoever committeth sin transgress also the law. And guess what? You need to understand, this ain't the law of America either. This is the law of the creator of the universe. That's why I can't get with Christianity, because there's a bunch of damn hypocrites. They're a bunch of religious relics. For sin is a transgression of the law. I can't even get with a bunch of these damn so-called Hebrews either. They ain't nothing but just Christians using Hebrew terms, Hebrew garments, and Hebrew philosophies. We have to separate from the people of the world. Did y'all hear that?
Yeah.
Yep. The cultural leader is saying separate from the people of the world. If you don't, you ain't going to know who you are. You're going to be lost, because there ain't nobody in here strong enough to soak and immerse themselves in that world and not end up becoming like them. You may like the character of Joseph, but you ain't no Joseph. If Potiphar's wife would have came flaunting her fine ass up in front of you, boy, it'd have been doom, 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 doom. It was that making love between the seats. Ooh, baby, baby. Well, not me. You're a liar. King David would have been between the sheets. You people, boy, you. You ever been, these people so, they so religiously think they're so holy, they so defiled, because they ain't got no pure minds. See, if I talk about stuff like this, because unto the pure all things are pure. But unto them that are defiled and unbelieving, there's nothing pure. Well, I can't believe you talk like that. You said it plenty of times before. It just, I put voice to it. Look how I'm looking. I'm telling you right now, I ain't no Joseph. No, don't even, that me and Potiphar's wife been getting down. And then I'd have been hanging by the gallows. It better be good. Because I'd have been dangling. Oh, never mind. Are you sorry women trying to act like you something? If Joseph was sitting up there and he was a wicked man and he was dangling himself in front of you, you'd have... Joseph! If we're going to maintain our holiness about being truly set apart, I watch people throw Yah away. I watch them just literally throw them away. They just throw away Yah. When one of their children decides to be a sodomite, I've seen family members come in here so, y'all, y'all, y'all. And as soon as one of their children, male or female, one decides to be a sodomite, the other decides to be a lesbian, they throw away y'all for love of the children. I'm a little bit different. To hell with you. And if we was in our culture, I'd be the first one to stone and kill your ass. Yeah, I love you enough to wipe you off the face of planet Earth so you don't pervert somebody else. But you, oh, my baby, you next. And I'm telling you, we don't have this kind of manhood and love for y'all today. Very few people possess this kind of strength. You'll be making excuse for these transgressors. And in everything that we do in this life, if Yah brings a false prophet in front of you, you know he's testing you. If he brings a false brother in front of you, do you know he's testing you? You ever read that before? He's testing you to see if you love him. Found out a bunch of you slanders and lies don't love Yah at all. So you end up getting carried away. Hallelujah. I watch people throw away Yah when their daughter becomes a lesbian. Genesis 18:20 says, Yahweh said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous. Revelations 18:4 says, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people. Now even the Bible is teaching you to come out. Come away from these people. That you be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. Why you think that's the reason why Yah said, there's a reason why I have severed you from the other nations of the earth. I've given you righteous laws and commandments, because all these, when you go read Leviticus 18, you go read Deuteronomy 20 and 22, and it's talking about all these sins, all these lustful sins of the flesh. He's warning us about taking on the same behavior as the Canaanites. Now we in America, you think he stopped warning us? We already got the law. We already have the prophets. Jesus, even in his day, said, you let them hear them. Well, who we listen to today? Yah in sundry times has spoken to us by the prophets. But he has in these last days spoken to us by his son. They're all consistent in their message. Y'all ain't gonna change because America came. The only thing that y'all ever changes on, and it's not really a change, he's just adapting according to the conditions. There used to be a time when we used to all run around in our birthday suits. But because sin entered the world, y'all had to clothe us. See, that's a change because of conditions. Can somebody just say hallelujah or something like that? Are you here? I mean, if I'm up here exerting all this energy, man, I do deserve a little bit of credit, man. If you wouldn't pay some money to go see a damn concert, you'd be cutting a damn fool. If you was at the speech when the president was speaking to Congress, you'd been up golf clapping. Unless you're a Democrat, you'd have been sitting on your hands. But even the Bible teaches us to come out so we don't receive our plagues. 2 Corinthians 6:17 says, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Master, and touch not the unclean thing. Then he said, I will receive you. You're not going to participate in the sins of this world and think that Yah is going to receive you. See, you've been sloppy graced half to death, thinking you can live any old kind of way, think any old kind of way, talk any old kind of way, and you're not going to answer for it. And I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, said the Almighty Yahweh. Ephesians 5:11 says, and have no fellowship, no what? With the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather do what? Reprove them. For it is a shame to even speak of those things which are done in secret. Pastor, can I tell you what I've done? I really don't want to know. Just tell me what spirit you're going after. Well, Pastor, I did this and I did that. Brother, I don't give a damn about all that. If you make y'all's conditions, you won't go after this spirit. Let's get out our Father's business. Some of you, you can't wait to hear somebody tell you what they've done in secret so you can go run and tell it yourself. Some of you, your mouth is just a damn garbage can. Your whole spirit is a garbage can. Some of you can't even hold your water. Don't you trust every brother and sister here just because they're sitting here. There's some hypocrites in here to the highest order and degree, and the worst kind too. You tell some of these boogers something, it'll be on. It'll be the National Enquirer of Straightway Ministries. Extra, extra! You better know who you're dealing with. Some of you, you still to this day, you ain't got a handle on gossip and slander. You're still weak. Kinsman Redeemer. Y'all ready for this? Huh? See if I can remember these names, all right? Anybody know who that is? Nobody don't know who that is? This is Bo Biden. This is Haley Biden. Bo Biden died of brain cancer a few years ago in 2015. Haley Biden, his wife now, is a widow. Y'all tracking so far? Y'all know who this is? This is Hunter Biden. That's Bo Biden's younger brother. This is Kathleen Biden. This is Hunter Biden's wife. We all right? Bo Biden and Hunter Biden is Vice President, used to be Joe Biden's sons. Y'all ready? Hunter Biden is now, they say, dating. Who is that? Haley Biden. The deceased widow of his brother. Y'all get that? Watch this. Hunter Biden and Kathleen, whatever her name is, close enough. You follow me? They are now separated. I wonder why. She filed for divorce in December 2016. Y'all get that? Why? Because she is now with, he is now with, all you Christians out there, your Christian reformer called Martin Luther would say instead of him divorcing his first wife, he should just go ahead and marry his brother's wife, kinsman redeemer. This is happening at the highest levels in the land. Serial polygamy. You see, what they're doing is serial polygamy. Because in their system of law, in order to make it right, even though it's wrong, he has to put away this other one that has not given him a reason to put her away. And then the family kicks her to the curb just in order for him to be able to marry to his brother's wife. And guess what? He got father's approval too. Notice, I said he has father's approval. So while you dumbasses running around here talking about who you going to marry and who you going to get married to, they doing more of the book than you are. Even though it's a perverted way. Anybody, we all know Brother Al down at Carmel Hill in Georgia, right? Brother Al's the head of the community down there. Brother Al's a strong man, an intelligent man. Y'all met him before? Brother Al got his stuff together. Brother Al said, Pastor, I got a lady I'm interested in. I said, just bring her up here. You know what Brother Al did? No, he did like y'all do. I'm a grown man. I can do what I want. That That's because he has a high level of honor, respect, and love and esteem for me. Mm-hmm. He wasn't going to marry her or touch her unless he got approval from me. Mind you, he's already had a wife pass away, beautiful Sister Erica, and he's got the daughter. You hear what I say? He bought that sister up here, and I said, okay. I looked at her. I said, that's all I need to know. I said, brother, whenever you get ready. But with some of you, where's my honor? Brother Al has a community and 10 acres. He lived 8 hours from here, 6 to 8 hours from here. A man that is in authority and under authority. If I'm your pastor, where's my honor? I didn't pick her. I didn't choose her. Brother Al probably heard the message and said, you know what? I guarantee that Pastor Dowell is a pretty good judge of hindquarters, character. How is it that I can just look at her? I say, just look at her. It's called discerning of spirits, one of the gifts of the Spirit. There are 9 gifts to the Spirit, of the Spirit, and that's one of them. You think you got it, but you ain't got it because all you discern is evil. You ain't operating in the gift if all you can discern is evil. Ask him when I see it. I ain't. All right. Just for the luxury of it, he came down and just sit down and talk. Brother, I'm already settled. Isn't that something? Well, he ain't got to come to you. Well, who he going to go to then? See, and then I got men out here attacking faithful men like Brother Eric Robinson. And brother, you think I'm going to let somebody just attack Brother Eric Robinson, Brother Al? I told Brother Eric, stand down. I did. I told brother, you stand down. And we watched the vileness come out of this brother. You heard it. I read it verbatim. I would have had to go and restrain Brother Al to stand him down. Because Brother Al's type of guy, I'm going to jump in my truck, say that crap to my face. And he don't care who you are. You'll be Andre the Giant. See, brothers, they pick and choose. They know who they so-called brave against. Why don't you call me a chump? Isn't this amazing? Damn hypocrites. Y'all see what it takes to really truly be a shepherd in this generation? Brother Eric, this brother right here, man, I could go out there and see an order in the way. What? Let me see. Didn't Abraham in the book of Jasher went to go visit Ishmael? He got there. Ishmael wasn't there. This woman was cussing. Was she not? She was cutting a fool. Was she not? Abraham said, I tell you what. I'm going to leave a message for my son. Please deliver it to him. Tell him I said, put this steak away. She in another culture. She don't know code. Some of you ought have got a text message. Pastor, what did you mean? He's the only man in this ministry whose wife has ever cut a fool that I said, put her away, and he did it. Rest of you, well, I don't know about all that. Damn sissies. And end up winning his whole entire family. I seen her, I said, sister, you don't understand how honorable you are and how beautiful you are. That's why I said to her. I said, let me, hold on for a second. Let me do this for myself for a second, all right? Some of you too damn prideful. So you don't think that I know them that labor among me? You don't think Yah don't know them that are his? Yeah, he do too. We talking about examples of honor right here in front of us. Everybody wants to have a nice, beautiful, peaceful life. You just don't want to sacrifice yourself in order to get it. They just honor me as a man because they know I'm a good judge of character. The reason why most people don't even want my opinion is because, take a guess reason why they don't want it. Because they're afraid I'm going to say no. If you're already afraid I'm going to say no, then why pursue? You already got, your own conscience has judged you. How can we get about our Father's business raising a strong nation for all these little teenagers and little bitty ones coming behind us if we're running dirty and acting like a bunch of banshees and coyotes and hypocrites? Yes. See, the problem is all of us, you have forgotten where you come from. And if you don't know where you come from, let me break it down for you. You come from piss and shit. None of us have been reared in the laws and statutes and commandments. None of us. None of us grew up reared in the instructions. None of us heard the writings of the Nabeens. None of us. Did y'all hear what I said? Not a one of us. And y'all's trying to preserve us as a people by protecting us from ourselves. Because some of the stuff we got going on in Israel, I promise you, there ain't no way David would have put up with that in the culture. You see, Moses didn't put up with it. See, we have this illusion of breathing that we're getting by. You just come out of being a staunch Gentile for many, many moons. And you come over this and being on here and only in 12 moons, yet you're the model Hebrew. You better shut your mouth. All we doing today is embolden the children to be more wicked than we ever been. When they see the way we carry ourselves. You know that it's human nature to gravitate towards iniquity and wickedness. Don't nobody say, look at that strong man. I want to be just like him. I want to set it free, and I want to learn from them. There ain't very few people do that. Look at that holy sister over there, set apart, meek and humble and strong in the Most High Yah. A praying woman, a fasting woman. Don't no girls want to be around that. They want to be around this shake of ass. Somebody tell me what I said wrong. This thing gonna come, it's gonna come from us. That's why the word repent, for the kingdom of Shemaim is at hand. It's hard trying to restore the culture. We gotta get the world out of you. You come with so much world. You hear the word, the first thing pops up in your mind is world. And don't think that many of you could actually live. I'm telling you, you can't live it straight. You think you can live it straight way. I'm going to tell you what. This is how the devil's a master at pointing his finger at everybody else. When you live here, you're going to meet the most wicked person that ever lived. You. And you ain't going to like what you see. And so in order for your vision to be clouded, you got to point your finger at everybody else and blame them for you. In order to justify yourself, make yourself feel better. When it's you. You know how I know that? Because ain't nobody ever left here and showed us how to do this. Not one person. Not a one person has ever showed us in what manner of holiness we ought to live and be. Because boy, if I see it, I promise you, I would follow it. I'd say, man, I ain't got it. They got it. We going over there. Oh, hallelujah. The instructions are still right. Infidel. The word infidel means somebody that is actively disbelieving. Specifically a heathen. Passively untrustworthy person. That believe it or not, they are faithless. It's even go to the point of calling them an incredible thing. An infidel, unbelieving, not to be trusted, incredulous. 1 Timothy 5:8 says, but if any provide not for his own, especially for his own house, he is denied the what?
Faith.
What faith are we in? Somebody say the faith of Abraham.
Faith of Abraham.
And he is worse than an infidel. So you call yourself a Hebrew and not take care of your home, and you're an infidel. You can dress like a Hebrew, not take care of your home, you're an infidel. Y'all hearing me? Y'all young men over there hearing me? Sodomite. A male devoted by prostitution to licentious idolatry. Sodomite, unclean abuser of oneself. Self of mankind defiles on oneself with mankind. One who lies with male as with a female. Sodomite, homosexual. All across this country, they celebrate the rights of sodomy. As soon as the Supreme Court brought that verdict down, before they even brought it down, they already had the lights in place. You don't think they already knew what they were going to do? San Francisco. The Empire State Building. The Cinderella Palace at Walt Disney. Better be careful, Disney. Deuteronomy 23:17 says, there shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel, nor a sodomite or the sons of Israel. If a man also lie with mankind as he lie with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to what? Death. Their blood shall be upon them. You know what Christianity does? They'll go and finger Islam and say, look at them. They calling for death and people do stuff like this. What do? Y'all call for life. And then you claim to be following his book, and your same book calls for death as well. Hypocrites, they just say the God of America's government. Deuteronomy 22:5, a woman shall not wear that which pertains unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment, for all that do so are an abomination to Yahweh Elohim. I heard somebody the other day trying to sit up there and justify a woman wearing birches. See, what happens is when we are immersed and when we have soaked ourselves in another culture, in another society, we begin to look through their lenses and their eyes, and then we begin to weigh what we call righteousness and holiness based on what we see. So if she has on pants and they loose pants, then that's all right. She's still covered. But if you go back far enough, that's why you got to get past all this culture of Christianity and these so-called church fathers. the priest was only allowed to wear birches, not women. A woman couldn't gird up her loins. There was a time in this country you would have never saw a woman or caught with a pair of pants on or trousers. But see, since we've declined and we done fallen, they rationalize and justify everything now. See, we are nomad people, believe it or not. Our culture is that way. Believe it or not, Hebrew culture is basically farmers, agricultural people. How agricultural are these people in these cities? And they call themselves preaching. The way our culture used to preach was is that they would be out of the city, then they will go into the city and preach, and then they will go right back out and go home. Christ would actually send his disciples before him to go to the cities and let them know I'm coming. So when I'm telling you to get out of the city, I know it's going to take you some time to get out. I'm not telling you to get out of the city because I want to inconvenience you. The reason why my words stick like super glue is because you know that the vessel that it's coming from is not a hypocrite. See, you ain't got no wiggle room when I start talking. You see what I mean? Can you imagine these sisters wearing Vanity Fair, Maybelline and Jezebel makeup, going to the well to get some water? Oh, let me get out of the tent. Let me put my makeup on. I can't go outside without my face. I got to go milk the goat. See, we're so far from who we really ought to be that we despise our way. And there's not another way on the face of planet Earth than give you the peace of this walk. But it comes through sacrifice. There has to be obedience. It's just the truth. Hey, Leviticus 18:22, thou shalt not lie with mankind as with a womankind, it is an abomination. Y'all hear that, men? Young men? Now I'm going to preach love today, nothing but the truth. The world is after the attention of your children. It's all about the children. Those who will not enter into the kingdom. The world is after the attention of your children. So here you go, Romans 1:24. Y'all know the passage. Wherefore, y'all also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts. How were they given over to uncleanness? Because James even tells us that if we're drawn away, we're drawn away based on the lust that already it is in us. See, believe it or not, there's a potential in you to be a homosexual. Oh, no, not me. Oh, you damn liar, you. So let me see. Christ can be tempted in every point, yet without sin, but you can't be tempted. You see, it's your mind. It's the way you've been. You're just screwed up in the head. That's your problem. You're proud. Yeah, it is. And because you can't acknowledge it, you can't guard your heart. You don't know how to guard your heart. I didn't say you want to be. I said the potential is there. If Christ can be tempted in all points yet without sin, I guess you're greater than he is then. But I know better than that because the Bible said the disciple is not greater than his Lord. Yeah, it's in you, sisters, to actually be a lesbian. Yeah, there's a spirit in you. Well, not in me. I don't want to. I guess you're greater than Christ then. I didn't say you want to be. I didn't say you want entertainment. But you keep soak yourself and mercilessly yourself around that mess long enough. You're going to be compromising morals and values. That's why a homosexual is never comfortable around me. I ain't even got to say a word. There's just something just radiating off of me. They can tell this cat don't like me. I sure don't. Christianity dress it up for you. Give you a loophole to give place so you can get sucked into it. Hate the sin, love the sinner, Well, damn it, the sinner is the one who has come in league with sin. What, y'all just gonna throw sin in the lake of fire and leave you unscathed? What kind of crazy mindset is this? So there's something in us already. There's something already in these people, except these people have no governor. Our governor is his word. To dishonor their own body between themselves, who changed the truth of Yah into a lie and worshiped and served the creature more than the creator who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause Yah gave them over into vile affections, and even their women did change the natural use to that which is against nature. And likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one to another. Men work with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of the error, which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain Yahweh in their knowledge. Now I ask you a question. Do we live in a generation where people love hearing Yah's word? You ever try to talk to a Christian about Yah's word and notice how antichrist they are? They don't even want to hear. To us, man, that's our favorite pastime. Huh? They don't even want to talk about it. So therefore, Yah gave more to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Being filled, notice, with all what? Unrighteous and what? Somebody say whoredoms. Wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness. Look at this. Full of what? Do you have any of this in you? Not only the spirit of sodomy, but do you have any of these in you too? Because I keep telling you, sodomites are very militant people. Yes, they are too. They're very vile, angry people. Full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignant, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, black, you know, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient parents. Some of you, Facebook has done, only thing that Facebook is done with me and you has become an avenue for you to foam out all of this. And you just hide behind Facebook while you're doing it. Some of you, you can't even talk or carry on a conversation without this. Showing how wicked you are. Yeah, Facebook ain't nothing but another outlet to whisper, debate, backbiters, haters of Yah, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents. Boy, ain't that a generation. Without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful. All of these people who knowing the judgment of Yah, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. You ever notice that anytime any of these disgruntled people, when they're getting ready to want to go talk to somebody that see things their way, they go spend a year because you have the same pleasure to do the same things that they do. That's why they come talk to you. People don't talk to me like they talk to you. Everywhere you look, false preachers are trying to sanitize the word. Ephesians 5:1. Be ye therefore followers of Yah's dear children. 1 Corinthians 6:9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of Yah? Be not deceived, neither whoredoms, whores or whoremongers, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor what? What are we dealing with now in this generation? 2017, who would ever thought? You know, I used to read this. Back in 1992, man, I'd be saying, I don't see this. Man, I say, ain't no way it could be time. You didn't see this in 92. I didn't see this in school. Tell them you don't see it now. You can't turn ahead without seeing it. nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor rebels, nor extortioners, shall inherit the kingdom of Yahweh. Then he says, but and such were some of you. Didn't you used to be at least one of them things? Well, if you well, Pastor, I used to be, but I still fight with some of you. With hey, well, you ain't supposed to continue in sin and expect y'all's grace. You're supposed to be dead to this stuff. How long does it take to die? See, you got the mindset, well, if I'm plugged up to life support, it could take a few years. Technically, you all right? You're justified in the name of Master Jesus by the Spirit of Yah. Ephesians 5:2. Walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given to us an offering and a sacrifice to Yah for a sweet Savior. But fornication, meaning whoredoms, and all uncleanliness and covetousness, let it not be once named among you. Yeah, that includes envy, backbiting, jealousy. All those things. Don't forget. It's not only just about sodomy and lesbians and homos. Don't let it be once named one of you good saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather give thanks. For this we know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater have any and what? Notice they use the word inheritance. Because the inheritance means you have to be in a family. In the kingdom of Yah and of Christ. Let no man deceive you with vain words because of the things that come upon the of Yah, come up a wrath of Yah upon the children of disobedience. See, when you continue to keep disobeying, you are manifesting that you are a child of the devil. You can dress up, look like a Hebrew, still the devil. Devil's an emulator. Be ye not therefore partakers with them. For you were sometime darkness, but now you are light in Yahshua. Walk as the children of light. Galatians 5:19. Now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft. Hey, when's the last time you dealt with that? Or variance, or emulation, or wrath. When's the last time you dealt with that? Or strife, huh? When's the last time you've been involved in this one? Seditions or heresy. See, some of you put a cheap price on your eternal salvation. Or how about this one? Envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such alike, of which I tell you before, as I've told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not, notice there's the key word again, inherit, meaning you was in the family, the reign of Elohim. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is what? You know there ain't nothing in the Torah written against that? There's nothing in the instructions against that. You can do that all day long. You can soak yourself, immerse yourself, backstroke yourself, swim across the Nile at yourself in this stuff. You got an itch and a scratch to do something, do this. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And then Christ have what? Modern translation, they have actively crucified the wicked flesh that they know that they have. With the affections and the lust. 1 Timothy 1:10, for whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind and men stealers. See, there it is again, them that defile themselves with what? Sodomites. For liars, for perjured persons. This one right here, for what? Liars. Liars. I need to bring this up because maybe new people watching. Did Rahab the harlot lie? No, she didn't. But in your mind today in this American culture society, y'all would say she lied. So you tell me, how can a liar be put in the faith chapter of Hebrews 11? Huh? How? See, it's the way you think. Was David a deceiver when he was over there drooling at the mouth? You would call it that. Yes, you would. See, it depends on who you deal with. You preserving life, it ain't a lie. Especially an Israelite lie. Oh, hallelujah. They can say, man, the neighbor say, I seen Brother Ron over there. I seen him. That one right there. He was the one that was over there. He killed that cow. And I go, Brother Ron, did you kill that cow? Brother Ron, no, I didn't kill that cow, Gentile cow. And then the cops come and say to me, well, where was he at? I said, he was sitting right here in my house drinking some wine with me. I don't know how he could be in two places at one time. Did I lie? No, I preserved an Israelite in the face of a heathen. And believe it or not, in their system of law, there's no such thing as a lie. It's all about strategy. See, they've been culturally rearing you. True, tell the truth. You said that truth. And you start singing like a canary. Up here. Up here. They just had the cops come up here for two, second week in a row. There was a man up here the cops came to serve a warrant on. The guy opened up the door. There's another guy next door, had a little boy, a baby in his hand, right? And then the dog comes out, runs all the way over to the other side and bites the child. So the cops kills the dog. And the guy had more affection for the dog, his dog, than the child it bit. See, without natural affection. And my dog, we've had a dog here just that even years ago that even went and attacked. We did. I'm the only one that had any little semblance of control. It was a Rottweiler, full grown. I should have never got it from someone. Already betraying with somebody else. And I'm the only one that had any control. Because I was at the gas pump, putting pump in, that booger snapped at my hand. Pow! About broke my hand too. So this booger attacks. I come home. This booger somehow done got off the leash and stuff, and he's chasing, turn the whole damn community upside down. Trying to bite this one little girl. Portia, wasn't it? Trying to bite this one little girl. I said, damn it. I said, I'll get his ass. I promise you that. I got his ass tied up in that tree. I took a damn axe handle and beat his ass into an inch of his life. We were going at it, boy. I gave him plenty of rope, plenty of chain, too. And he was, he tried to bite me, man. I was filling his head up with that damn axe. And then, boy, I got him one good time, right on top of the head. Pow! And I still kept beating his ass. I beat his ass till blood come out his eyes, his ass, and his lips. Then I left him laying down his blood for a long time. Y'all remember that time y'all seen me chasing his damn horse in his corral with that damn axe handle trying to beat that booger with it? That was funny because I was out of breath. That damn horse fast. That horse is fast, boy. Woo wee. Oh, never mind. For whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind, man stealers, and liars, perjured person, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine. I think my battery's up. No, I mean. So what does love really do? 1 Corinthians 13:6. Look what charity does. Rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Some of you get mad and angry when the truth come your way. Or when someone's telling the truth on you, showing you full of iniquity. Won't you hate the garment spotted by the flesh? Huh? Just hate the garment spotted by the flesh. What Jesus said about eternal life. Don't everybody want eternal life? Mark 10, 17, and when he was gone forth in the way, and there came one running and kneeling to him and asked him, good master, what shall I do that I may, what's that word again? That means you're part of a family. What? Eternal? When Jordan and I go out, I ain't been out with Jordan. Why? Who is that? I says, my daughter. Who? They can't tell me they ain't my daughter. Can't you see the resemblance? That's my adopted daughter. Come here, Jordan. Come here, Gabriel and Ariel and Elias. Y'all come on up here. Look at all these children I got. They all look just like me. Come over here, Gabriel. See, don't he look just like me? Look at all the muscles he got up there. Y'all stand close. Don't he look just like me? Everywhere we go, these are my children. Because they be. And they're really flabbergasted when they hear, Dad. Now what do, you pack of jackals? Good looking crew up here too, isn't it? I wish I looked that good when I was younger. Nice young crew up here. Don't y'all let this go to y'all head either. You know, Lies even getting some muscle on him too. Look at that. Getting puffed up here. Now you got to put your shoulders back a little bit more like this. Now straight. There you go. Some good children. You know, because all of these are over 15. We got some coming up. And these are good children. They're teenagers in the world, but they're children to us. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, bless y'all. Y'all have a seat. Y'all have your moment of glory. And Jesus said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is Yah. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness. That boy, we have trouble with that one, don't we? Do not defraud. Honor thy father and mother. And he answered, said unto him, Master, all these I observed from my youth. And then Jesus beholding him, and look at this key word right here. He did what? That means he's getting ready to tell him something to where your heart is getting ready to really be challenged. Huh? Do you get that? The other guy, he's confident, man. And then Jesus looked at him. He's like, oh, boy. Now he's going to love him. You know, love is really tough. Do y'all know that? This love that is easy, that ain't love. Gee. I suppose you think you're lovable. Tina just lost it. I suppose all you really truly think, you just lovable, huh? You all lovable. Okay. He loved him. And said unto him, one thing that you lack is go that way and do what? See, we can't even say it. It hurts to even say it. Sell. I'm still waiting on the deed entitled to that land, Brother Randy. Y'all can tell I ain't getting that right. See what happens when people speak arrogantly and make mouths at? See, I'll tell you, here's a good example of somebody expecting more out of others than what they're able to produce themselves. I could go to any of these other lands and say, sign them over the straightway, no problem. Because they know why? You know why? Because they know a righteous man. You know there are a lot of people that are envious and jealous for us for being righteous? You know the reason why they're away? Because they ain't righteous. You know, a righteous man don't need no law. Because he obeys the law. Oh, Jesus. Sell whatsoever you have. Give it to who? Poor. Let's define the poor. The poor are the ones that have the what? Gospel preached to them. So how y'all doing, poor folks? All you did was left one poor state to another poor state. But we're going to be rich. We rich already, and y'all. We already rich. We only here for a short period of time. Y'all is testing your heart, because wherever your treasure is, and if you can't get rid of something, we know where your heart is. I remember years ago, some of y'all can see if you, I vaguely just popped in my mind this story. We was at a meeting, and this one guy was testing me and trying me over if I could give, like that book says. I said, whatever you see, I got, ask for anything. If I got it, I'll give it to you. He goes, okay, give me that watch. I said, here. And that was a nice watch. Stopped his mouth, and I said, oh, wait a minute. My turn. See, his treasure was in material things. Watches. I don't mind telling you, he didn't want that one. He didn't want that test. And then the first thing these people want to do is call you cult because you obey Yah. You ought to tell people, thank you for calling me a part of a good culture. We know what they mean, but that don't mean you have to receive it the way they mean it. You just tell them, I understand you're ignorant, you're dumb. You're a passive, ignorant fool. We understand that. You don't understand the etymology of words. You're speaking to your little vain, vile heart. That's why I don't get upset. And now, if it's really in them, you're going to tap into a spirit, boy. So that's how you get people to gnaw on you and gnash on you with their teeth. This thing's spiritual, saints. It really is. And I'm not doing this because we have to still test and try every spirit. Isn't that right? What would possess a man to sit up there and speak so arrogantly against one brother, and then the very things that you expect for this brother to do, you can't do yourself? Huh? Y'all ain't never seen me behave like that. Have y'all ever seen me get on that video and say, well, look what I did, and I've done, and I, and never included the saints? There ain't nothing in the kingdom or the work that is designed that only one person can do it. Most people are so arrogant and proud, they can't say, man, that brother built that right there. I had a brother... I think it was Brother Cherry, either Brother Desmond, one of them two asked me, they said, who built that over at that corner right there? I said, Brother Scott, the brother right there, Brother Scott built that thing. He said, man, they do good work. Yep, sure does. Now, I just missed out on my moment of glory. But who built it? Brother Scott built it. I told you, any teacher that's got any worth always hopes that a student surpasses him. We something, ain't we? Ain't we something? Let me tell you something. Everything you ever got in this world has been given to you. Well, I'll work for it. Yeah, somebody gave you a paycheck, didn't they? Wise guy. Sell whatsoever thou hast, give it to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure where? And see, our eyes are not really centered and focused on what? Heaven. Making innuendos and videos out there. Can y'all believe it? Let me see. Yeah, the leaders are really, truly the only ones that benefits at the community. I heard that statement. Elder Rufus heard that statement too, because he actually bought it to me. Nobody was around. Hardly anybody was around when Pastor Dye lived in the poorest conditions on this community. Before I'd even build me a deck, I made sure that everybody else had a deck or a porch. The home I live in now used to be the fellowship hall and the gym. We got homes out here that the people that are in it, they're the only ones that's ever lived in it. And they are homes. And there are more homes going up. But see, people who don't know this, they want to paint a negative picture to negatively influence anybody out there who should be listening to us. See how vile his spirit is? They don't call names, but you know who they saying. Amazing. Utterly amazing. And take up your tree and follow him. And he was sad. Remember, Christ loved him. And he became very sad at that saying. I offered Brother Rich a house out here years ago. When we was doing the building, Brother Rich said, man, ain't no disrespect, dishonor, but not right now. The way my children are, He's not speaking nothing negative. He says, My family, nope, not right now. We were tied up. Isn't that an honorable thing? For him to say, no, maybe later, but not right now. Did you say that, Brother Rich, am I making up stuff? People don't, they think they know us. They don't know us. Oh, next accusation. He always drives around in the best of things. Yep, I drive around in the good ship Jesus. But see, when I go and test their boast, then they find themselves wanting and waiting in the balance. Because there ain't a vehicle out here that I personally have only driven. Look at them looking. As a matter of fact, I drive all of them except them little bitty ones. Man, them things be tearing my knees up, boy. Now I'll be wrestling with Brother Brent. I mean, the favorite truck to drive out here is that F-250. Yeah. And now when Brother Britt, you can tell he been in there because the steering wheel is all the way down to the brakes. He drives with the steering wheel all the way down to the brakes, man. Oh, hallelujah. You people are something. Deacon Bell, when you went to Straightway, Georgia, what vehicle did you drive? You drove that old Chevrolet that Brother Rich drive back and forth to work, right? That thing that stayed broke down. That's when you and your family went down to. Is that right? Is that what you went down in? What did y'all drive?
We drove the Escalade.
Oh. And some of you wouldn't even let nobody drive your worst car. Matter of fact, you could have two of them and wouldn't even give it up for a week. Hypocrites. See, they can't stand the fact that the reality is staring you right in the face. That there are people that's doing our best to do what that book says. Sister Victoria, come here for a second. She's live back into you calling Nation.
That's right.
Sister Victoria is a faithful sister in the ministry. You know what she did? She didn't ask me to say none of this. You know what she does? And she's been doing it ever since she's been here. Not only does she give monetarily physical Federal Reserve notes, she went out and got a Home Depot credit card. You have to forgive me if I don't get the numbers right, because sometimes I forget numbers, okay? And she'll say, Pastor, here, take the card and you can spend $1,500 or $1,000 or $500, because I see all the building you're doing. And I'd bring the card back to her. Would I go a penny over any with you? She says, wow, that's amazing. He said, because to the penny, that's what you spent. I said, that's what you told me. She says, man, I've given people stuff like this. And they say, well, you know, I had to go a little bit over. You know, I'm like, are you serious? I said, you should have went over the top of their damn head and cracked it too. Pow! You're going to have that kind of dishonor and disrespect when someone is blessing you? Is that not treacherous and deceitful? Sad, isn't it? That when you turn around and abuse a fellow brother or sister like that. You actually got it in my name too, didn't you? Got it in my name. Say, Pastor, I got a card right here for you in your name. I was like, what? Thank you, sister. Isn't that beautiful?
Yes, sir.
And time would literally fail me if I tell you what all these saints do. You jealous hypocrites. It's sad, isn't it? And the people, if they haven't contributed anything monetarily, they gave more than all by giving themselves. Everybody in this ministry is a giver. Wherever your treasure is, I guess the devil just hates when people are doing it, ain't they? Bro, Jermaine is the one who helped keep my YouTube page running. Ministry page and stuff. I call him up and say, brother, this thing's cutting the damn food. He said, what is it? I said, I don't know. You take care of it, man. I don't know what the hell it is. I have this thing disabled and everything else, man. I fool around with this thing. It's crazy. And he was sad for that saying and went away grieving, but he had great possessions. So I ask you, did the possessions own him or did he own the possessions? And Jesus looked around about and said unto his disciples, how hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of Yah? And the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answered again and said unto them, children, how hard it is for them that trust in riches. Notice I slowed down. To enter into the reign of Yahweh Elohim. For it is easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of Yah. You ain't got to worry about Donald Trump going to the kingdom of Yah. You ain't got to worry about it. None of them billionaires. None of them Goldman Sachs and J.D. won't. No, they won't. There's so much money in this world that everybody in the world, there's so much wealth in this world that everybody could actually have a home and a dignified life. It wasn't so much greed from the wealthy. And they were astonished. Look at this. Out of measure. Saying among themselves, who then can be saved? If this rich man, who have great riches, if he can't sell what he got and give it up, and this rich man, he better than we are. That's how we see things. Then who can be saved? That's the question that's being asked. And Jesus looking upon him saying, with men it is impossible, but with Yah, for with all Yah, all things are what? Possible. Then Peter began to say unto him, lo, we have what? Left all to have followed thee. Well, this was in Jesus' day. This ain't for our day. Oh, let me see. Jesus Christ saying, yesterday, today, and forever. I'm Yahweh Elohim, and I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. See, what we do is we cherry pick. We cherry pick. And Jesus answered, verily, or truly I say unto you, there is no man that have left house or brethren or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and for the message. See, I know that I ain't gave up really nothing. What'd I give up? A pathetic, miserable life? Huh? Of debt and taxes? But shall receive a hundredfold when? What's that word say? Now you see the reason why many of you will never know the blessings of Yah? Because you can't do the first. Oh, wait a minute. I thought you said y'all read the Bible. I thought you said you believe the book. In this what? Houses, brothers, sisters, and mothers, and children, and lands, with what? So we embrace persecution like a glove. We know we're going to be falsely accused, misrepresented, lied on, everything. We wear it like a glove. Most time we laugh at it. And in the world to come, guess what we're going to have? So we ain't gave up nothing. Keep this world. But many of the first shall be last, last shall be first. This is Candace Wiggins. Right there. Beautiful, beautiful looking woman. She's a heterosexual. That means she's married to a man and she lives straight. She's a WNBA basketball champion and played for four teams and has been in the league at least 8 years. 30 years old, she said, I can't take it no more. I decide to quit. You know the reason why? Because the WNBA is 98% lesbians. And she's blowing a whistle on all of them. She says, I have been beaten, abused, mistreated by the lesbian organizations of the whole entire WNBA. They can't forsake her talent because she's talented. She said, I've never been called so many bees in all my life. She said, the culture was deaf to me. The WNBA, Women's National Basketball Team, there she is with a championship trophy. There she is when she played for the Sparks, played for the Lynx, and whoever this DraftKings, that must be an all-star game. It's a lesbian organization. She said 98% of the women in that basketball league are all lesbians. And you know what? This militant, wicked, defiled. Now, wait a minute. Let me get this right. This is the culture, talking about these lesbians, sodomites, that they want everybody to feel sorry for them because of the mistreatment that they get in society. And here's these damn hypocrites turn around persecuting someone that is straight. See, and this story is gaining traction. It can't be ignored. Isn't that something?
Yes, sir.
I told you they are militant bastards.
Yeah.
Can't even be content with it. So what does the prophets of Israel say? Isaiah 1:9, except Yahweh of hosts had left unto us a very small remnant, we should have all been as Sodom, and we should have all been like unto Gomorrah. Y'all understand that we are part of that very small remnant? You shouldn't take it. I'm telling you, you shouldn't take it. Y'all should be very honored to know that you've got the ears to hear in the midst of this wicked and perverse generation. Very honored. But I'm telling you, you are part of a remnant. And a remnant means a very small number. Did you think we was going to be in this walk and nobody was going to persecute us? And all they that live godly shall suffer persecution. Did y'all hear that? That's how you read the book.
Come on.
And this country is finished. Heed the warning. Isaiah 45:20, assemble yourselves and come and draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations. See, some of your soul escaped. Like the bird out of the snare of a fowler. They have no knowledge that set up wood or graven images and pray to a God that cannot save. Acts 2:40, and with many words did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourself from what, saints? This untoward generation. This generation is wicked as hell. That's why I scream. That's why I cry aloud. That's why I shout. And that's the reason why I've got to be, man, and I said it last night on the broadcast. I said, man, I am more tough than I have ever been. Man, I speak harshly, man. I didn't used to go back and look at the archives. I didn't used to talk like this. And then I said, I know it is. It's a wicked, vile, and perverse generation. You got to come hard. This is such a hard spirit. Any weakness, boy, they're going to take it as meekness and they're going to try to trample all over you. They're going to take that meekness as weakness, man. They're going to trample all over you. I'm going to hit you with that Louisville baseball bat that Brother Freeman got me. I got it sitting right by the door. Louisville slugger. Israel, we got to fight. Because this world is out to change everything. I see this little baby. That's the brain. Little Nehemiah up here. This little booger. Man, you may see this booger halfway hanging out of a chair with one leg down, caught between the other, and just he content, man. He just doing his thing. You know, that's all right. See this little dude right here? Look at him. He a mess too, ain't he? Man, I be seeing this little dude. And when I hold these little babies and I see him, I go, boy, whew, man, what kind of world are they coming in?
Yeah.
I said, man, that's the reason why we work so hard at Straightway. Brothers don't always tell us what we doing. It ain't for us. We may be here living in it, working and stuff, but we have what our job is. We have to build and maintain for this generation coming behind, and then teach them so that they can be the generation to say, you know what? I was reared and raised in the law and the instructions. And all we got to do from this point is teach them how to keep what they got, because the world gonna try to get it. We know what we're doing is for these generations. And this world don't want y'all listening to what y'all hearing. That's the reason why they come out so hard against me. Because they make a lot of noise, but they can't condemn a thing I say. They can't come against it. Can't nobody in the world come against it. There ain't nobody out there that can call Pastor Dow a liar and be truthful in doing it. So, I mean, I love our little children. Man, I got all kind of grandbabies now. But man, I see these little children, man, that's always at the forefront of my heart. What are we going to build and keep for them? We got to be able to do it. And then we got to have some type of business that the world can't get a hold of, so that they'll be able to have some income coming in. And if that, maybe we didn't have enough silver because it's going to go back to it by then. Ain't that right, son? This little boy, I'm telling you, this little boy, he is something else. All right, bless you. He's something else. All right, Israel? Oh, hallelujah. Y'all's good. Hope you people on the other side of that camera are listening. Let me finish on these two scriptures. How do you get the nature of Yah? 2 Peter 3, 1 through 3 says, according to his divine power, have given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that have called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceedingly great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers, here it is, of the divine nature. See, when you receive this knowledge, you're becoming a partaker of Yah's divine nature. When you receive these promises, you receive this word, and then it becomes part of your life, and you walk in it, you're receiving Yah's divine nature. Y'all get it, Israel? Having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. See, Yah wants you to escape yourself, believe it or not. This world ain't got nothing for you. Ain't got nothing for you. Isn't it a beautiful thing? Don't y'all look forward to Sabbath when it comes around? Man, we be looking forward every week. I be asking, what day is this? I ask it all the time, what day is this? Why? So we can rest. We building something in the midst of this generation. And don't expect everybody to comprehend and understand. They ain't. Hallelujah. We are the offscouring of the earth. Hallelujah. Let us stand, Israel. Yah is good. Abba Yah, we thank you for all things we pray these things sink deep down our hearts in the mighty name of Yeshua. Hallelujah. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of thy heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Yah, my strength, my redeemer. Dismiss in the beautiful, wonderful, and magnificent name of Yahshua HaMashiach, Yahweh Almighty. Shabbat Shalom, King coming.
Uh-oh, look at him looking.